Welcome to the Bob Sullivan Show. And with your host, it's Bob Sullivan.
Thank you for joining me for another edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Today I have on with me, from the Chicago Bliss, Kimberly Anderson. How are you doing today, Kimberly?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
So are you a Bulls fan?
Am I a Bulls fan? I was a Bulls fan when Jordan was on the team, and I was really into it when I was playing basketball, and I still am a Bulls fan. I just went to the Knicks game probably about a month ago. It was excellent. They're doing really well.
Yeah. You got to be devastated by the Derrick Rose injury, right?
I know. It's such a bad time for that. I mean, what was he thinking? Just kidding. But, I mean, it's just bad timing, and Bulls will just have to pull through. And, you know, without him, they got to make it happen. So, hopefully that will happen.
Speaking of injuries, what happened? You said that you have you've just had surgery. What is the injury, and what did they need to correct there?
Well, I didn't really have an injury. I just had a virus, and they had to laser the virus out of my foot. So really nothing too detrimental. It just is an annoying recovery. Playing around all day.
How difficult is that to go from doing like activities, like being active all the time, and then not being able to not being able to walk, not being able to do much? How is that for a person in athletics like yourself?
It's horrible. I don't sit still ever. I mean, I'm just a busy body. Like you said, I'm running around all the time, whether I'm working out, practicing, working, doing whatever. I don't sit at home very often. So to be here all week, I can't believe it's day five, and I was kind of like getting crazy. I was so excited to do the show. So I'm like, I got something to do. While I sit.
Well, you're the first to be excited about being on the show.
Aww.
I hope I'm kidding when I say that. But what were you doing to prepare for the upcoming season? What's a typical off season like for a lingerie football player?
I'm typically working out about 6 days a week, so about an hour and a half to 2 hours a day. I work out on my own, doing various workout activities, and then I also personal train with Ivan Rodriguez. So. He puts me through everything. I mean, we flip 300-pound tires, we do sweat, lots of sprinting, lots of speed and agility, so a lot of TRX suspension work, just a ton of different things that keep me motivated to work out and get stronger for the following season.
Did you end up going to watch the tryouts, or did you have to participate in tryouts? What was the deal there for you?
All of the above. I definitely was at the tryouts. I'm the market manager for Chicago Bliss as well, so I organize all the paperwork and check all the girls in, which is so much fun for me. I love seeing who's coming in and encouraging them to, you know, do their best for the tryout. We also, the Bliss girls all come and we participate in some of the drills, just kind of demonstrate more than actually do the tryouts for the girls that are coming in. So we're not doing a lot of the work, but definitely doing some demonstrations. I did a couple of routes, wide receiver drills, and took some pictures and was posting things online so people could see what was going on. And, you know, it's a fun day. It's a long day, but it's fun.
What's the acceptance process for a rookie? What do you guys do to rookies to make sure that they know that, like, in the NFL, I mean, I know you guys aren't making millions of dollars like the NFL, but they have, like, the rookie buy dinner for the entire team. What's the thing that you have to do to be accepted on the lingerie football team?
Wow, we don't get dinner, but they just have to make the cut.
Oh.
They just have to say that. That's it. Don't ask you. Just make the cut. And they follow, you know, do a perform a series of drills, kind of like the NFL Combine. They're doing the 40-yard dash, 4-cone drills, 3-cone drills, you know, all kinds of things. We did a bench press as one of our stations. So just a bunch of a series of drills that the coaches can get an idea of how athletic they are and what their timing would be on those drills, for quickness as well as agility.
How do you what do you do to stay in not only football shape but also to be sexy? What do you do to keep that going? Because you don't want to get too buff. I mean, you don't want to get, you know.
Right.
What do you do to stay in that right look, I guess, for the LFL?
Like I said, I just work out continually, stay toned. I have a diet per se, but I wouldn't say it's, I don't know. For me, it doesn't have to be so horrible, I guess. Yeah. I just cut out a lot of snacking. I'm huge on candy and chips and cheese and all that kind of chips and dips and all that fatty stuff. So I kind of just cut that out and limit my snacking throughout the day.
Mm-hmm.
But otherwise, you know, just eat as the best that I can and a lot of cardio and a lot of working out. So.
What's the hardest snack you've had to cut out?
Oh, probably nachos are my favorite. Oh. Nachos and candy. I mean, I've been known to wake up in the middle of the night and get some Mike and Ike's out. You know, the drawer next to my bed.
Mm-hmm.
I love candy. I can eat all day long. So those things are definitely the hardest, but I'm kind of the person I am is if I cut it out and don't think about it for a while, and I could just move on and not have it. But the minute I have it, it's just in my head, and I'm thinking about it all the time. And I just want to run over and, you know, get some candy. Or, you know, at the movies, I just want to have an awesome big tray of nachos with lots of cheese. So, you know, when I forget about it, it's okay. But I can't have a taste like some people can have. Oh, I'll just have 5 M&Ms,
yeah.
And it'll satisfy my crave. No, my crave lasts too long. Like, it's all or nothing. And I can't have it all, then I just don't eat it at all.
I hate so. Those people that are able to, like, I hate when the people are like, well, just have one. Just have
yeah.
one. It's not realistic.
Not for me, no. It's not enough. Once I have a taste in my mouth, I don't want it to go away, so I just have to finish it till it's gone.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, I guess I don't have a lot of willpower.
What about, how many people in the world of lingerie football have not been able, like, would you say that have... lot like an NFL like or an NBA player, you'd say like Amari Stoudemire. He has not been he's not been the same since the lockout, and his back has kind of gone out on him because he gained too much weight. Has there been cases like that in like lingerie football where maybe women can't give up the snacking or they get pregnant? What's the biggest retirement reason for women in the lingerie football league?
I don't know overall. I know that, I mean, we have a uniform to wear that's one size fits all, so it's definitely an important part of being on the team is to make sure you are in shape, and it's not because they just want these girls to look good. I mean, we do want to look good, but the fact of the matter is we're athletes and we should look good, otherwise... if you're an athlete and you don't look good, I don't know how you could call yourself an athlete, you know? I mean, per se. Because athletes are working hard, we're diligent, we're staying toned, and we don't really have a lot of time to be eating a bunch of junk if you are doing what you need to do to be ready for the season. I haven't experienced any girls leaving because they were pregnant, so I'm very lucky in that regard, but it's definitely come up.
Especially now that we have a year until our next game, regular season game, anybody could get pregnant, you know, within a year. That's a long time. So, I mean,
I'm sure it has happened. I just haven't heard about it. But as to the weight gain, the league is, they're not horrible about it. They may mention to you to tone up, but I haven't, you know, on our team, we haven't had many girls that have been told they couldn't play because of their weight, which is, you know, it's really nice to not be told that.
What's the biggest amount of, like, I mean, in high schools and, like, I mean, just about, I mean, it's not just high school. I mean, it goes throughout the world of not just growing up, but the human element is to gossip. And, like, I went to my I went to visit my grandma at her nursing home, and they're talking about, like, she smokes in her room. And, like, that's what everybody's talking about at the dinner table, is why Noreen, or whatever her name is smoking in her room. And my argument is, who cares if Noreen's smoking in the room? I think the argument should be, I'm worried about the 90-year-old woman who's smoking that could burn down the building that my grandma's living in. Like, what's the main, like, thing of, like, like, is there a gossip column on the Lingerie Football League, or is there, like, because there's always, like, those websites for, like, NFL, NBA. What goes on in the LFL that people don't know about?
I don't think we have too much gossip going on, which I guess when you ask me that question, it's kind of nice to know that. And, you know, there's a lot of talk on what players are just good out there, you know, who's good on what team. And there's talk about, you know, people that get cut for various reasons, whether or not fulfilling the promotional part of being on the team or whatever reason, or people that leave. I think the most gossip is who left and why, and when we don't know, it triggers some gossip because people are just curious, like, what happened, and where'd this chick go, and, you know, how could she just leave like that and not tell us an answer? So I think the gossip is at a minimum. We don't have a lot of time to do that. We have to learn our plays. We have to, when we're at practice, it's strictly practice. I mean, we only have so much time. We don't have a facility that we can go to whenever we want to practice. We have a certain days and certain times, and we need to get a job done in those times. And then when we're at promotion, you know, we're promoting the league. So we don't have a lot of downtime to just sit around and gossip as a team. There may be some individual gossip on, you know, amongst a couple of players at a time, but I wouldn't say as a league we're too gossipy. I mean, besides what everything that you've seen on websites and on Chicago Bliss page, I mean, that's all out there. So
yeah. That's
probably the extent of the gossip.
What do you think of, like, I'm not completely up on, I mean, like, I started interviewing lingerie football players, and I'm not really, and I've watched games on, what's it, on MTV2, and, I mean, you guys are legitimately playing football, and you're not playing in much pad at all. What is the toll that it takes on your body to recover from game to game?
It's a lot, and especially if the girls are playing on turf,
mm-hmm.
You know, the turf burns, you have to recover from those, you have to treat them properly so they don't get any infections. I mean, and then if you get injured in a game, that's a recovery in itself. So, and it recovers for the whole team. When a girl gets injured, we have to fill that spot as well as bring somebody else in that can make us be as good as we were. So there's a lot of injuries, a lot of small injuries, I would say, more than the really more severe ones.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of hand injuries, nerve injuries. We do have a lot of concussions, though, too, in practice and in games. So we're very conscious of those and making sure that the girls are taking care of themselves, because that's a very serious injury. I mean, most injuries are serious, but that one can affect your brain and the long run. So we're very cognizant of those kinds of injuries. But, I mean, it's pretty brutal. My theory on the pads, though, I mean, we don't have a lot of pads that is cracked, but, you know, really, the main places you get injuries are joints, where your joints move. And, you know, you can't ever protect that. You have to protect your joints. You can't pad your knees, your ankles, your hips, your... You can't pad those areas so they don't move.
Right.
So, really, the pads, what we have, it works. Maybe we should have more, but that would take away from our cute uniforms, that's for sure. So, it's very controversial how much padding we have when we're playing this rough sport. Because, I mean, the hits are real, and they're hard, and the injuries are real. But, at the end of the day, like, you can't protect your joints, really. I mean, you're either going to play and be injured or cry. So, you go into the league knowing that injury is to be a part of this sport, and you just accept it, because any sport you play in, I mean, look at Derek Rose, he just tore his ACL playing basketball.
Right.
So, I mean, if he could hear basketball, we could have lots of injuries playing football. But you love the sport, and you don't care. You don't think about the injuries. You know, anybody who is in any sport or anything that has a high risk of injury doesn't go into it thinking, oh, I'm going to get injured. You know, you would never do it if you were so concerned. So you go into it with high hopes, and you hope whatever injuries you get are minimal. And then, you know, you go from there. But the injuries are real, and they're serious. So. I know our quarterback, Heather Fish, she has had some knee injuries. She's had some shoulder injuries. So I have staff on the site at our practice who work with our injured and make sure that they're staying healthy and they get healthy as soon as they can so they can continue to play.
Like, what, do you know who Jim Stoos is?
I don't think I do.
Okay, well, he's this, like...
guy Jim Stoos is kind of like a gossip columnist, and, like, he researches, but you just don't know, like, how much of it is really true and how much of it is for, like, to Hollywoodize what... to, like, better his name. Like, how much of that has come into, like... Obviously, since you don't know who he is, that's probably not a good thing for him, but how much do you... Like, how much bad stuff have you heard about the LFL, and how much does that stuff bother you, or do you just not even think about it?
I hear a lot of bad things about the LFL, and for some people, I would say they're just naive to the situation. For others, I feel that they have some good information there, and their opinion is their opinion, but the only thing I would say is that you either like it and go along with it, or you don't. And, you know, the LFL is going to change. But for me, I am on it, and until it affects me at a moral standard where I have to do something that I will not do, then I will leave. So they're not going to change for me. But for me, I'm on a team, and I am playing, and I'm not doing anything that I don't feel isn't correct or isn't right, or is it something I should do? And there are aspects about the league where people are very upset, and, you know, they don't understand, you know, why we don't really get paid and all this stuff, but, mm-hmm. You know, it's a beginning league, and if you do some research on the NFL, they didn't get paid in the beginning either.
Right.
They had to promote and get their league together as well, and this league has just started, and I just think, you know, you either roll with it or you go home. That's really my only thing I can say about any comments that anyone has. You like it and you do it, or you don't and you just go home. You know, nobody's making stay. Nobody's forcing any of these people to be on the team. It's that simple. So I say that to people who have negative comments that I go research it a little more so that you kind of maybe some of the things that you think might be proved wrong. Or you might find that they're correct, and you don't have to like it. Nobody's expecting people to like everything that the LFL is doing. But
right.
The owner, Mitch Murtaugh, is doing what he feels is right, and it's obviously working. I mean, the league is spreading like wildfire throughout the other countries, and, you know, you either like what he does or you leave. That's it. He does it. You know, I don't know. That's just my view on it. So... I like what's going on so far, and I have a full-time job. I'm a teacher,
right.
So I don't need a staff. I mean, I wouldn't I'm not saying I'd say no to money, but I don't need a salary. I have a job. I have a career. And this is just something I'm doing on the side to be an athlete, in, you know, as an adult. Not many girls get to do that. And I'm just so grateful that I get to and that I'm accepted on the team and I'm allowed to have this opportunity. So,
How many teachers, like they, there's always so many, like, you know, like, a lot of the, I mean, of course, guys are naturally going to be attracted to the product because it's women in lingerie, but once they get there, they realize that it's real football, it's not Powder Puff, and... I've seen not up close, but I've seen on TV that it's not a patty cake league, and people don't realize that. But I think, like, how much of the criticism from the league do you think comes more from like women activists who haven't really been to the game because they think it's feminists who think that it's really degrading women, which, I mean, okay, it is. I mean, you guys do have to play in lingerie, but you have a choice and you're playing for free. That's not, I mean, it's one thing if you were getting paid, like, if you were forced to play or something, like your company forced you to play, but you didn't. How many nasty emails or whatever, like, people protesting have there been at games, or is there such thing?
I haven't experienced it in that much of a volume, like not in a crowd of people who are at the games, like irate and upset. I've heard comments when we're doing promos at the bar, women can tend to be a little, I don't know, they're really not receptive unless they know what it's about, and then they're really excited. So I think from a girl's standpoint, when you talk to other girls, they're either on board or they're not. With guys, they're most likely on board when you talk to them about what we're doing. But, I mean, the fact of the matter is, I think it's, you know, they're looking at just the gimmick. They're looking at the name lingerie, and then they're just taking to a level that it really isn't. The outfits we wear aren't really lingerie. I mean, it says that it is, but we wear sports bra and boy shorts, which doesn't look like any of the lingerie I own, and it certainly covers much more than my bikini. And girls play volleyball and bikinis, which are a lot more revealing than our uniforms, especially since we wear pads, helmets, shoulder pads, knee pads, I mean, gloves, shoes. So, I mean, we're almost all covered, whereas girls are playing volleyball or, you know, doing other sports and things with less clothing on than us. But because they don't have the lingerie title, you know, people don't look at it like it's a big deal. And because our outfits have lace on it or little details in the uniform that make it look lingerie-ish, it becomes a problem. And I have to admit, I was one of those people when my husband told me about it. For like 3 months, I wouldn't even look at it. I'm like, I'm a teacher. I can't be doing something like this, you know? And I was stuck on that word in the title. And then when I really looked into it and found out how respected it is for the game that we're playing, and, you know, for someone like me who can wear a bikini all day long, I mean, I will, you know, pitch my bushes in my bikini because I don't want to get weird tan lines. So really, it was a really... I was excited. I'm like, wow, I get to play this sport and wear like a really cute outfit. but I mean, everyone's going to have an opinion, and the gimmick is what makes it work. Mm-hmm. Like, everyone I've met has said the lingerie gets you there. You know, that title gets people in the seats, but what keeps them there is the game. And, you know, we've got NFL players that told us how awesome our games are and how surprised they are, how hard we hit and how vigorous the sport is. I mean, we technically have less rules than the NFL. I mean, we can pretty much do anything on that field. So, for people that are so focused on lingerie, it doesn't bother me. That's the opinion, and they're entitled to it just as we are to do what we're doing. But, you know, I mean, I think we just focus on one little aspect of the whole entire realm of what the LFL is, and the lingerie part is just a gimmick. It's just a great gimmick that gets people there and gets people interested, and it's what's making it what it is today.
Now you're a wide receiver and you're a safety, and in the NFL and other sports, they're in it, like the wide receiver is the diva, and I mean it gets a bad name from like T.O. and Ocho Cinco and Randy Moss and people like that. Are you a diva? Are you a
I'm working on being a diva. I haven't played a lot on the field. There are a few games, so I'm working on it. But the wide receivers on our team are divas, and they do a really good job. So we're competing with each other to have that role, and I'm working on it.
How much trash gets talked in lingerie football? How much trash talking is there?
Oh, God. It's encouraged. So, like... Ooh. I mean, it's so encouraged. So if you're not talking trash, you know, the camera's almost shut off because that's what they're looking for. I mean, there's so much trash talking on the field. If they could open mic everyone on the field, because it's going on probably the entire time. So there's so much. So much.
How do you draw the line between talking trash to somebody? Like, how often has trash talk from the game before carried into work the next week with students? Where are you, maybe some girl drops a pass and you say, bitch, you can't, you're not going to catch that in my house. Or how often have you almost had to talk trash to one of your students after?
I haven't. It doesn't translate. Those two totally different jobs. Yeah. I got to work, so... I don't let any of that get to me at work, and I'm not really thinking about football when I'm teaching. I'm thinking about my job as a teacher, so it doesn't translate very well, which I guess is good, right?
Yeah, that is good, because you don't want to drop you don't want to drop an F-bomb or call a kid a name while you're teaching them.
No, I probably would lose my job. I don't think I would have a career anymore. That's way too important to me, so I can't rush out on that. I would never do that. Everything that happens on the field stays on the field, and once everything's all said and done, everyone's, you know, acquaintances or friends off the field. It's just in the moment you're playing the game, you're getting heated, and you know you're out to kill that other team, and you need to have that mindset when you're on the field. But when it's all said and done, it's over, and you know the winner wins, and the loser's mad and it's gonna do everything they can to win the next game.
Who's somebody that gets under your skin that is a good trash talker and can really get you riled up when you're playing?
I think I'm too easygoing, but I know V on our team can talk some good trash. She definitely can talk some good trash that can get into your head. But from other teams, I know the LA team they're reigning champs, and they are huge trash talkers. So I'm sure some of that may have gotten into, you know, some of the girls' heads when they played LA. But other than that, I know
that
I don't have any good stories.
Tess Barea is pretty big trash talker, I know that.
They are. LA comes out beastly, man. They're just all over the place talking trash all the time. And, you know, it must be working for them because they keep winning. So,
Well, what's going to be the key for Chicago Bliss this upcoming season to not only get past the Omaha team, the expansion Omaha team, but also get past, like, Green Bay's coming back. Minnesota's pretty decent. Seattle's always good. The Sin, Temptation, obviously the class of the West. What's going to be the key to get to that lingerie football title game and
shock the world, so to speak? What do you guys have to do? What do you have to improve on?
We're a great team. We have a lot of talent. It just needs to be organized, and we need to have some consistency. So as long as we can keep key players that we've had, or just key players throughout from now till next year, that'll help in itself. And the consistency with our coaches coming back this year, that's going to help keep us in some sort of direction that we need to go. We also need to get our casting game on so that we can pass as well as we run the ball, and that'll help. So a few little things that we need to work on, and we've got plenty of time to do it, but I know our girls can do it. We have the talent. We have it all there. It just needs to come together, right. And the consistency is definitely one of the biggest things that needs to happen. So.
What does Omaha have to look out for when their expansion team plays the Bliss?
Oh, they're going to have a lot to look out for. I mean, we've got girls on the team that have been on there for a few years, and we have girls from last year coming back that are awesome. And, you know, they're a new team, so they're lucky that they have a year to work. Usually you only get a few months, and if you're an advanced team, that's all you have. And the girls on other teams have been together longer. So they're going to have to watch out for everyone, and they're going to really have to focus on, you know, working together as a team and getting something together, because, you know, I mean, they're new, and they're going to have to get their game face on, because everyone has had theirs on for quite some time.
Well, what's the hazing process going to be for the Omaha team? What are you guys going to do to them to welcome them to the league? Is it going to be like...
We're going to take them out. We're going to hopefully send some home injured, and, you know, when we play them, they're not going to have a prayer. Okay. So that's what we're going to do.
Yeah, I'm not too confident right now. I don't even know if they've had tryouts or gotten tryouts going yet, so I'm a little behind.
Yeah, I have no confidence to them. They're new. I mean, yeah. We'll see. But, I mean, Vegas did well this year, and they were a new expansion team. But I know the league started out with a lot of players from different markets in the NFL, and I know it didn't end up completely that way, but they were a pretty good expansion team. The Green Bay, they're all right. They did all right this year. But I don't know. I think Omaha is just lucky. They should consider themselves lucky. They have a year to prepare. So they better use their time wisely.
Well, you better watch out when you're talking trash about my Omaha team. That they're... I'm not offended yet, but I might be down the road. And might... So... What goals do you have for this upcoming season? What's a personal goal? What's a team goal? And what is a a league wide goal for the LFL?
For me, a personal goal is to play more. Like I said, I haven't played in many games, and if I have, it hasn't been for long periods of time. But I'm working my way up there, and I just want to play more. I want more time on the field. Yeah, it feels like no other, and it's really the coolest thing ever. So I definitely want to become a better wide receiver, a better safety, a better corner, back, whichever position coach thinks that I need to play, and to get me out on that field. I mean, my heart is to play more. For a team goal, we definitely need a sense of unity. We need a team that comes together on the field and off the field at promotion and all that kind of stuff. They need to be a part of the team as a whole and not just for for the game, you know, and just for practice. We need our team to come together and be a little bit more of a team that's just united much better. But I think we're on our way with the consistency. That's going to help. So I'm very excited. I can already tell that the league is headed in that direction, especially with the new girls coming on. They seem very excited and amped and ready to be a part of the team for every aspect. And for the league, I think it's just to keep promoting. I mean, we all need to. All the markets in the U.S. have to keep promoting in the off-season, because we don't want our fans to forget about us. I mean, they'll never forget about us. How could you? But we don't want them to be like, well, what happened to that LFL team? And then it's too late when our games come around and we don't have great attendance. So I know, as being the market manager for the Chicago Bliss, I've already got things planned for the summer. We're going to keep on chucking rackets, like as if we're going to start playing again in August, and keep promos going and keep our name out there and keep our fans excited, so that when next year comes, they're going to be you know, we're going to pack that stadium, and it's going to be, you know, sold out because people have just been dying for our game to start.
Last thing before I let you go, where does the what's your prediction for a record in the, or what's your prediction for how you guys finish in 2013? I know that's a really long time away, and we don't know if there's going to be an apocalypse. Let's predict, barring an apocalypse, how did the Chicago Bliss do in 2013?
Well, I mean, the only view that we have right now is 4-0. So regular season games, if there's only four, we're going 4-0. We're gonna, you know, fight our hardest and take back what we used to be a couple of years ago. We were 4-0 team and we made it to the championship, and we want to be the team to beat LA in the championship. I think the fans want it, and I know we want it, and we're ready for it. So there's no other way. It has to be 4-0. That's it. And we need to go into it thinking that we're going to be a 4-0 team,
because
that's what we're
going to
be.
Is there anything else you want to talk about before I let you go then?
No, I just want to reiterate that, you know, just because our season's postponed, we're not canceled. Our entire week has not been canceled. We are not gone. We are here, and we are just going to have more time to prepare since the Canadian League is getting started right now. And just to have people watch, I believe it's on pay-per-view. You can watch the All Fantasy game. That's this Saturday, Cinco de Mayo, in Mexico. And we have two of our most awesome girls that are there representing the Chicago Bliss. We have Heather Furr, Brianna Schultz, and Christelle Harris. So I definitely want to promote that. And we're doing a huge bar crawl in Wrigleyville on June 23rd. So we would love people to visit my site and check out the events page to get their tickets to that, because it's going to be awesome.
If you send me that link, I'll post it on with the show then and post it on my website so people can visit that then.
Awesome. I would do that for sure. And I want to thank you so much for having me. It's great that we get to have these opportunities. So.
Yeah, no problem. I'm glad to do it. I'm a big LFL supporter. A lot of great work and effort that you guys put into the league, and I appreciate all the work you guys do to promote it and make sure that you're putting on the best possible product that not only women can be proud of, but also football can be proud of. So good work on that part.
It's awesome. We're glad you're a fan.
Well, I will be a Chicago Bliss fan until you guys ruin my life and beat the Omaha team.
Which we will, so just be our fan. They're not going to make it. I don't think they're
going to
make it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I don't think so. They're not going to cut it. We have too many carbs here in Omaha. Yeah.
I know. All those potatoes.
Well, I appreciate you coming on. We'll have to do this again soon, Kim. I appreciate it.
Sounds good. Thank you. Yep.